Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I am your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curator Distinguished Professor at Missouri S&T, and alongside me, as always, are my partners in crime, April Cheek Messier and John Long from the National D-Day Memorial. How are you guys doing today?
Hello. Very excited about today's discussion.
Hello, John. Doing great today.
Yeah, I'm excited too. Today, we have someone I've known long time from back at the University of Tennessee, where we were both in the doctoral program there. And this is Katherine Kate Landdeck, who's been kind enough to join us today. And Kate, first, just hello. Thanks for joining us. Then I want to tell the audience about your many accomplishments. How you doing?
Well, hi, John. Thanks so much. And hi to everybody. Thanks for having me today.
Yeah, so Kate Landdeck earned her doctorate, as I said, at the University of Tennessee, which we all know is an emblem of greatness, obviously, right there. We were both students of Dr. Charles W. Johnson, who was just a wonderful mentor on so many levels. And so Kate, at that point, began doing really like the seminal work on women's Air Force service pilots in World War II. And of course, eventually published this remarkable book called The Women with Silver Wings. That'll sort of be our focus today. But she is, in terms of all the places where she's appeared, she's been on A&E, the History Channel. She's a very active person in documentaries. She's taught for C-SPAN, American History Television Lecture and History Series. She's been on NPR. She's been on NBC News. Her work has appeared in The Atlantic, The Huffington Post. And of course, oh, by the way, she's a full professor of history at Texas Women's University, where she oversees a major internship program and does her ongoing research and mentors who knows how many students. So, you know, her work goes far and wide. So, Kate, it's just absolutely such an honor to have you today. Thanks.
Well, thanks so much, John. It's such a great pleasure. I was thrilled to be asked. So thank you.
Yeah. So let's get into the sort of the deep dive of your many years of work on the WASPs. I mean, this is just, it's a very personal story to you, I know, and we can discuss that. But maybe if you could just walk us through how you got involved in this story and where it came from. I mean, I know it was your dissertation work to some extent originally. But obviously, that's been a while ago, and you've really evolved with this story too, haven't you?
Yeah. And John, you're one of the few people who really understands how long of a journey this has been, and so I appreciate that. I actually started graduate school to learn to write history the right way. You know, to learn how to tell this story. I met my first WASP at an air show in 1993 in Tulsa, Oklahoma, or Bartlesville, Oklahoma. I was teaching at Spartan School of Aeronautics and had a shiny new bachelor's degree from Arkansas at Little Rock, and loved airplanes and loved World War II, or loved learning about World War II, and went up to this air show and walked up to meet Curtis Pitts, who designed one of the coolest airplanes ever, the Pitts Special. And after chatting with him, he turned to the woman next to him and said, "Let me introduce you to Carol Bailey Bosca. She won the 1951 aerobatic championship in my second airplane." And I was stunned because I didn't know that women had done that, had flown in the 1950s in that way. Everybody knows about Amelia Earhart, but that women were flying competitively in the 50s was a surprise. And at the end of a conversation with her, I discovered that she'd been a WASP, one of the women Air Force service pilots from World War II. And I was again stunned because I had never heard of these women. I loved airplanes. I studied World War II, and I had never heard of them. And I went back. I was teaching at Spartan School of Aeronautics for their associate degree. And none of the guys at the flight school had heard of them either. And I was just stunned. It's these women flew every airplane the Army Air Forces had from 1942 to 1944, and nobody I knew, including people in the aviation industry, had heard of them. Now, some people had, right? Outside of my small circle, but I just, I was stunned. And so Carol had given me her name and address on a note card. This is 1993, so there was no email addresses or anything like that. I carried that little orange note card in my purse. And you know, you don't know, but women know, you change your purse, right? And I kept that card in a special pocket in every purse I had because I didn't want to risk losing it. I was moving, you know, I was young. And I finally got admitted to the University of Tennessee, had moved to Tennessee by then. And I told Susan Becker in our methodology class, the first day of our methodology class with Susan Becker, she said, "And what are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I'm here to learn how to write history and research history so I can write about the women Air Force Service pilots." And that's how, you know, that's how it began. And obviously I'm very stubborn or something because I've stuck with it all these years.
And as an aside, Susan Becker was quite a taskmaster. I mean, she would put you through your paces. You did not, mess with her on any level. Kate, I think you and I are both better historians from mixing it up with Susan Becker. She was incredible, wasn't she?
She was. And she was a real mentor for my master's thesis, for sure. And she kept telling me, "You like them too much, Kate. You like them too much. Be careful." And so she really taught me to separate my emotions from "these are fun people. I like these people," because I was doing a lot of oral histories that Charles Johnson had taught me how to do and mentored me through. And she said, you know, "Be careful that you're not just telling the story that you want to tell because of how cool they are. You know, make sure you're getting the history." And that really was a message I've carried through the thesis and then the dissertation. And then I think through to the book. I've really worked hard to be balanced because these women were cool. They were so much fun. And I spent 25 years with them. I had a call. We're down to about 11 or 12 of them that are left. And I had a call with one of them last week. You know, she's 101 and we enjoy each other's company and talking to each other. But I've worked hard that it's not a story of just "these are cool women," but really a balanced story about the history and their role in it. So Susan Becker is why I think I still do that.
And Kate, we have a question from a listener that I want to, but first of all, I want to commend you on the book because it's absolutely wonderful. I many years ago started talking about the WASP through some lectures here at the Memorial to educate people about it. I mean, it's just an amazing story. And I think so many people were stunned that they had never heard the story before. And, you know, we're talking about a time in history when few women even had driver's licenses. And you've got this amazing story of these women who are flying every single aircraft in the military, you know, the Army Air Force's inventory. So it's just such an incredible story. Thank you for all your work and bringing it
to life. Well, thank you for that. Thank you. I appreciate that.
But we did have a listener in Virginia who submitted this question. Jennifer in Virginia asked, "It was only recently that I became aware of the WASP and the service of these women, yet I've known about the WACs and the WAVES for years. Why has this story been so submerged for so long in public memory?" And she says, "And thank you for raising awareness of it."
Well, that's a great question, and I appreciate it. I think, you know, the WASP were kind of odd ducks because they were not officially a part of the military, and so they didn't get the promotion, you know, the government propaganda during the war, I think. They were also a very small group, you know, where you have over 100,000 WACs, the Women's Army Corps. You know, there were 1,100 of the WASP who earned their wings, 1,830 who got their went through training. So it's such a small group, and they're not put on the stamps, and they're not in the official posters, and all of that official memorialization that happens after the war with the WAVES and things like that. People at the time you know, somewhat knew about them. They were on the cover of Life magazine. They're on the cover of Look magazine, which was a contemporary of Life. Great publication, all of this. Jacqueline Cochran and Nancy Love were in the New York Times all the time, you know, the women leaders. So this was in the news at the time, but I think it was such a busy time that their story could get lost during the war. And then in the post-war years, I think they just were forgotten. You know, there was such a small group and women weren't allowed to fly in the military or commercial aviation for the most part until the 1970s. So I think that was just, they were forgotten, and to a certain extent, they forgot themselves, right? They absorbed themselves back into society and we didn't learn about them. Hopefully, my goal of writing this book, and you know, I went with Crown Press, which is a division of Penguin Random House, rather than an academic press. And I did that on purpose. And I never want to walk into another room where people haven't heard about the WASP, where people are like, who are the WASP? You do what? Who? What? I want that to never happen. So that's my mission. So thank you guys. And thank her for helping spread that story, because it's a story that has to be told. And is so inspirational for sure. So thank you.
Kate, you mentioned Jacqueline Cochran, one of the major characters in your book, and I found her an absolutely fascinating woman. If you wrote her biography as a movie script, someone would probably tell you it was too far-fetched. Yet it is true. So tell us about Jackie and her role in this whole saga.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Jackie is a fascinating character. She is, you know, people either loved her or hated her. She did so much good for women and women in aviation. And at the same time, she put programs and discouraged women. So she's just an incredibly complicated character. And I think you're quite right that they would, you know, they might just say, the movie people might just say it's too far-fetched, 100%. You know, she was incredibly poor, like seriously poor, from a family in the panhandle of Florida and southern Alabama, the sawmills areas, and just hungry. And that hunger really drove her. She was very smart, very ambitious, and hit at a time where she was able to pull herself out of the poverty, first as a hairdresser, and then she finally moved to New York and worked as a hairdresser, was able to buy her own shop, and got her pilot's license. And about the time she had some of her great successes, she also met Floyd Odlum, who was the wealthiest man in the world, among the wealthiest men in the world, certainly one of the very wealthiest in the United States. And so that helps to have some financial support. But she drove herself and just made things happen. Became one of the most famous aviators in the 1930s, breaking records, flight records, men's records, racing, a friend of Amelia Earhart in that group of women. But never really accepted by a lot of the other women. She was just too much sometimes. You know, she was just too much sometimes. And I think that came from her insecurities, she made things happen, and rather than having the grace to let people do things for her. You know what I mean? She just, mm-hmm. She worked so hard, and the things she did, I don't know any other woman or man really that was able to achieve what she achieved, to come from nothing and to do the things she did. She was just an amazing woman.
Yeah. I mean, she had to work that hard. She had to be that forward. She had to develop that personality where she was always going to make things happen for herself. And that's just who she was, you know? And so
yeah.
One of the things that really stood out to me, Kate, is the sort of I mean, sort of the spinoff from this conversation is the kind of rivalry that she ends up having with Nancy Harkness Love, one of the other prominent WASPs. What's feeding into that dynamic? You're really covering.
Yeah, I think I'm glad you asked about Nancy. You know, Nancy Harkness Love was the other leader of this group of the WASP, and she, you know, had a different background. She came from, you know, more well-to-do family and was just more cultured. And I, you know, one of the fun things about my research lasting as long as it is I was able to finally find evidence that they knew each other in the 30s. You know, so many of the stories talk about them not meeting until the war years, but they all belonged to the Long Island Aviation Country Club. This was people like Charles Lindbergh and, you know, all the wealthiest people of the time loved airplanes, but Nancy Love, Jacqueline Cochran, Betty Gillies, all these very prominent aviation people belonged to this club. And I really think it was personalities, right? Jackie would come into a room and expect everyone to look at her. And she was new money. And I think that old conflict between new money and old money, between loud and trying to be cultured. You know, Jackie changed her accent from, you know, poor Southern to that, you know, that transatlantic accent that think of Katherine Hepburn and Cary Grant, that accent. She learned how to do that to try to fit in. And, you know, people who'd been around a while could see through it, I'm sure. And it was just a personality conflict, but it was an old one. And it's tragic because I think Nancy and Jackie should have been friends. They had similar ambitions. They both loved airplanes. They both supported women in aviation. But it wasn't to be. But they had different ideas about what they wanted for women during World War II, right? Nancy thought it should be this very elite group of highly experienced women being fully integrated into the firing command, where Jackie wanted to have thousands of women pilots doing all the domestic flying jobs for the Army Air Forces. And those are very separate programs, very different programs, different ideas. So while you have this history of, you know, kind of a personality differences, right? They're in the same crowd, but not together. And then add on to that layer of different ideas about what should be, and then add the different allies that they each had, right? Nancy worked with General Tunner and George, and Jackie had, you know, General Arnold in her corner. So you end up with this kind of lots of manipulation and work, and all in the context of, oh yeah, there's a global war going on. Let's try to do as much good as we can for that. So it was layers and layers of personalities going on here for sure.
Kate, as a follow-up to that, I'm curious because I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but Jackie is so intriguing to me because she broke mm-hmm. so many boundaries, and she, you know, certainly with everything that she competed in, even post-war when she competed in the Bendix race, she set a new speed record for propeller-driven aircraft. She became the first woman to break the sound barrier, all these things.
Yeah.
And yet it was really Jackie who kind of put some of the obstacles in the way of the women being of women actually flying in the military, you know, post-war and everything. She mm-hmm. really felt like there were very definite gender boundaries. Can you talk a little bit about that and her thoughts?
Yeah, no, I think, you know, you've obviously read very carefully. she's this very perfect example of a contrary woman, right? She breaks all these barriers and you know, bursts through the glass ceiling. I mean, literally the speed of sound. And then she gives testimony in the 1960s and 1970s against women serving in the military as pilots. and against women serving in the military at all, and says she wouldn't want to be in a commercial airliner with a pregnant woman in the cockpit. And, you know, says all these things, while at the same time, she's proving women can do all these things. And during the war, she proved women could do all those things. But she really was. And if you look at her letters and documents, it seems she was really a conservative woman, right? She had these traditional values and traditional views of what women should do. But she was also very conservative monetarily, right? She talked about, if you spend your money training women to fly these military planes, they're just going to get married and have babies, as is the natural thing to do, she would add, right? And it's a waste of money. So a lot of times when she presented this testimony, it wasn't ever that women weren't physically capable of doing it, or that women couldn't be as good a pilot as men. It was always couched in terms of the natural order of things is for women to marry and have children, and they are unnatural if they don't choose to do that. Now, this is a woman who didn't have children. She had a child when she was 14, who was tragically killed, but she did not stay home and raise that child. She was not home when he was killed. She was working, she was doing things. So she is just this, sometimes I wonder if the statements she makes about women serving in the military and women serving as commercial pilots was personal regrets, because she, in her later years, wished she had had a simpler life, or if it was, she understood the game very well. She was very savvy and very manipulative and wanted to have her opportunities. And the times in which she was giving this testimony and she was talking about these things, there was a lot of pushback from people in power, right? At the end of World War II, the WASP were disbanded in December 1944 because General Arnold had finally said, you know, we have enough men and we've gathered enough data for the experiment of women in piloting military planes we just don't need them anymore, and we don't want them replacing men, right? You can release men for flying duty, but you can't replace them. And, so was Jackie saying, no, you need to go home, because she thought women needed to go home in World War II, or no, you can't fly, you know, military planes in the 70s, because she thought women couldn't or shouldn't do that? Or was it because she was being savvy, because the political will wasn't there, and so she was going with what she thought was the winning side? I don't know. That's what makes her so interesting.
She is. She's so complex. There's so many layers to her. You know, it's funny, because I'm ashamed to say that the first I knew of the WASP was when you and I had a conversation about them, because you were working on it. I mean, way back when we were at Tennessee, that I didn't know anything about this.
That's okay. I'm happy to educate you anytime, Josh.
Well, and you have. I mean, and that's what I'm saying. It's just incredible. Talk about original work. I mean, so, yeah. But, you know, there's probably a number of folks listening to us now who may be at that point of not necessarily knowing who these folks were, how this all got started. So I wonder if you could just sort of give us some background on, you know, who the WASP were, how this program got started, and what they did.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, the Women Air Force Service pilots were technically civilians who served for the Army Air Forces. There was a fight, an expectation their entire service time in the service that they would be made a part of the Army Air Forces. So they followed all the military protocols. They could be court-martialed. They could be, they earned demerits. They, all of these things. And they went through the same training as the male cadets, their flight training. It was paralleled. Everything that the men coming into the Army Air Forces did to train, the women did. And they served from 1942 to 44. And the idea was, these were women who were going to come in and relieve men for overseas duty, right? The women were going to do the domestic flying, ferrying was the first area that they needed help in. You know, we think about Rosie the Riveter and all those stories we hear from the war of all the planes being built in the factories across the country, right? If you're building planes in Dallas and Detroit, you've got to get them to the points of embarkation. So they needed ferry pilots. So they first brought women in as ferry pilots. And then they realized women could do other domestic flying. They could tow targets behind the planes to train the gunners on the ground. They could, you know, fly non-flying personnel from place to place across the country. So they brought those talented and experienced women in as ferry pilots initially. And then they trained over 1,800 women, first in Houston, Texas, then in Sweetwater, Texas, at an Army Air Forces base to fly the Army way. And then they let them out into all those domestic flying jobs. So if you wanted to sum up what they did, there were 1,102 women who did all the domestic flying that needed to be done in the United States from 1942 to 1944.
Kate, once they established a program and started to recruit women for the WASP, what sort of qualities were they looking for beyond just, obviously, flight experience? And you mentioned that, I forget the numbers, but more tried out than actually won their wings. What led to some being disqualified?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So the criteria for these women was quite high. It changed over time. In the very beginning, it was 500 hours of flight time and a 200 horsepower rating, which not many people had at the time. It eventually dropped all the way down to 35 hours of flight training. These women all had to pass the military flight physical, the exact same physical that the men did. And had to have a letter of recommendation. They had to be a high school graduate, just those basic criteria. But you have to put these women into the context of the times. These are women who came of age in the golden age of aviation, right? Think Earhart, think Lindbergh, think all the adventures and air races. And people were airplane crazy. There's a fantastic book by Joseph Korn called The Winged Gospel that really, I think, shapes all of this period very nicely. But you had over 25,000 women who applied to this program. Excuse me. You had over 25,000 women apply to this program because they wanted to fly, and this was an incredible opportunity. Which meant that Jacqueline Cochran, who ran the training side of the program, was able to pick the best of the best. These were women who not only met those flight physicals and other requirements, but she would have a personal interview with each of these women, she or one of the women who worked for her. And so she made sure that they were smart and articulate and attractive, because she understood the games that she was going to have to play. If you look at pictures of them from the war, they're all very athletic looking, very fit, very attractive women. And of course, she ran a cosmetics company, Jackie did, so it didn't hurt to have, you know, all these beautiful women. But she also was able to narrow down them with education. Over 80% of these women who were admitted into the WASP training program had at least 2 years of college. This is at a time when only 4% of white women had college education. So these are women who are really the best educated. Now, she is very limiting on race. There were a number of Black women pilots who were available for flight training who would have been eligible. I know of the names of at least six, and they did meet all the criteria. But Jackie did not admit Black women into the flight training. Now, this is at a time when the Army Air Forces, the armed forces in general, were segregated. And so she was following that same path. She did have two Chinese American women in the program, a at least one, maybe two Native American women, and we know of three or four Hispanic women. But for the most part, this was a white women's organization.
Kate, those stories are, to me, what's really riveting in the book, too. You tell these individual stories of these women from all these different backgrounds, which I find so fascinating. One of the ones for me that stood out was Cornelia Fort, for example. I loved her story. You know, just the fact that she had this harrowing experience during the attack on Pearl Harbor, because she's actually in the air at the time, was just incredible to me. And but also a tragic story for her as well. Can you talk a little bit about that, but also stories that really resonated with you, that you, that stood out for you?
Sure. I think, you know, Cornelia Fort is one of those very interesting women. She's one of the first to be admitted as a ferry pilot from Nashville, Tennessee, very wealthy family, kind of a debutante, and did not want to be a debutante, wanted to fly airplanes. Did everything she could to get to do that, and eventually moved to Hawaii, where she could work as a flight instructor. And her story's recorded in other places, but she Cornelia Fort's story is one of the most famous and certainly memorable. She was a debutante from Nashville, didn't want to be, wanted to fly airplanes, and eventually moved to Hawaii, where she was in the air giving flight instruction. She was in a little tailor craft giving flight instruction when the Japanese attacked. She was right over Rogers Field and was strafed and barely survived. Then she comes back, eventually makes it back to the mainland, and does all sorts of radio programs and raising funds for bonds. But then as soon as the opportunity to serve as a pilot opened up, she ran to it and was so happy to serve as a pilot for the Army Air Forces, even as a civilian. But then she is tragically killed. She is the second woman killed. The first who was flying active, there was a student who was killed just a week before she was, but in a ferrying flight, another aircraft, they were both flying towards a radio check-in point, and the other pilot looked down and was having trouble with his radio and drifted over, and his wing crushed her cockpit, and she went into the ground over Central Texas. She survives Pearl Harbor, but doesn't survive a standard ferrying flight. It was quite tragic. And I think it was important because her death really made the women who were actively flying remember the potential cost. You know, she was well experienced, had survived Pearl Harbor, and yet she was killed. And I think that's something that all pilots in the era knew, I think all pilots today know, is that it can be dangerous and anything can happen. And the newspapers and the military notes at the time kind of went on about how the other women didn't get hysterical and that they just pressed on, that they were sad, but they pressed on. And some of the memos back and forth among the military folks were all surprised that this hadn't just scuttled the whole program. So I think that was significant.
Yeah, I mean, they thought that, you know, women would go to pieces in a crisis. Mm-hmm. This is a sort of classic thing. And it, so what's really struck me, too, to kind of circle back to something we were talking about a moment ago, is here's this arguably excluded group, women, kind of, you know, breaking a barrier here to make a contribution on the aerial side in World War II. And yet immediately as that happens, they're excluding another group, African-American women primarily, mm-hmm. which reflects to a great extent what's going on in the country at that point. But of course, by contrast, You know, African Americans were very much pushing back against Army Air Force's policies, and we end up, of course, with the Tuskegee Airmen, quite famously, and all of that. And so you do see, pilots and aviator, other, you know, crew personnel, or whatever, bring about some level of change, but you don't see that on the WASP side.
Yeah,
I mean, I wonder, was there more pushback from African-American female pilots during the war? Were they really lobbying Jackie Cochran? Was she having issues with this? What was the attitude of the other pilots in relation to integration? I mean, I wonder about that side of the equation.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question, John. And, Jackie talks about this in some oral histories from as early as 1960 and some of her letters at the time. And she says, you know, she had women come and she would always meet with them in person and explain to them that this is such a small program and we are struggling to get the opportunity for women to fly. And if we made this an integrated program, we would never have a chance. And that she talked about how she asked them if they understood. And of course they did. And they were so gracious about it and things like that. I think, the reality is these Black women pilots had the two strikes against them. You know, the Tuskegee Airmen were able to push and get a Black men flying program. The WASP were able to push and get a women's flying program. But to have Black women flying, that was just too much, I think. The argument was, and part of the struggle for the Tuskegee Airmen was you couldn't have Black pilots ferrying planes across the United States because of all the restrictions of things like hotels and restaurants and all those struggles that Black Americans faced in this era. And so you don't have Tuskegee Airmen serving as ferry pilots, which a lot of pilots in the Army Air Forces served as ferry pilots as part of their training, right, to get that cross-country training. And when you think about the WASP, they started as ferry pilots. So that's another conflict, is it was hard enough to have women serving as ferry pilots, but then to have Black women who would have that extra level of challenge. Jackie talked about the fact that, you know, she had women in her office and she always loved working with Black women. She said, you know, they always work harder, you know, kind of very interesting statements, but that the Black women pilots would be a little too much. Now, we know that, women like Janet Bragg, who's a prominent Black woman pilot in the era, talks about going and pushing back with Jackie. Now, Janet Bragg was a little on the edge of the age barrier, right? They could only be 35 was the limit. But she talks about that she pushed back. But other Black women pilots who applied and got the standard, thank you for your loyalty to the country, thank you for applying, but we can't take Black women right now, go join the WAC, obviously this was very disappointing to not have this opportunity. Many of the women had trained in the civilian pilot training program of the 30s with men who became Tuskegee Airmen. And some of them went and served in Tuskegee on the airfield itself. So they found other ways to serve. They found other ways to fly. But the doors were just closed to him here, in this training program. That's another story I would like to tell for sure, is those Black women pilots of the 30s and 40s. Because I think that's a story that needs to be told.
Yeah, absolutely. It strikes me that if we look at the longer sweep of American history since the abolition period, it's the same pattern. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, let's just have the men first. In terms of reform. Let's get Black men the vote first, and then let's we'll worry about the women later. Sort of. It seems like it's the exact same pattern here in World War II, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And even if in aviation, you look at pilots today, commercial pilots, with only 7% of all pilots are women, and only 2% of those hold the ATP, which is the airline transport pilot that you have to have to be, you know, to fly the big airliners. And then the percentage of those women who are Black women is you know, statistically inconsequential. So it's something that is disappointing that so little has actually changed. The opportunity's there, but the representation certainly hasn't arrived.
Kate, I was curious, you know, when I was reading your story about Colonel Paul Tibbetts and everything, it made me think of another story I'd heard too about one of the WASP, Del Shar, who had looked at the problems with the P-39 and was really just the incredible initiative that so many of these women took to figure out why planes acted the way they did, or you know, for example, that one overheating on the runway, how do you fix that? And she was one who dove right into the problem and solved it. And you tell a similar story with the B-29. Can you, for our listeners, tell us what Colonel Paul Tibbetts asked of them and why that was important?
Yeah, exactly. And this is, of course, one of my favorite stories. I had the great fortune of knowing Paul Tibbetts pretty well. And he loved telling the story. He loved the WASP that he knew the best, Dora Dougherty and Dee Dee Mormon. And, you know, as your audience knows, the B-29 was essential to the war, particularly the war in the Pacific. It was designed by Boeing during the war, and it had some serious problems, right? The cowling was too tight around the engines, and they used a different kind of metals in the engine itself, within the casing. And it was overheating, and they were having a lot of serious engine fires. They'd had a very tragic crash of a test flight that crashed at the end of the runway in Seattle and crashed into a meatpacking plant. People on the ground were killed. It was all very highly publicized, the problems that they were having with this B-29, to the point that the men pilots in the Army Air Forces were refusing to fly it. And there were a lot of dangerous planes in World War II. And for them to put their foot down on this one was a big deal. But of course, you know, the B-29 was pressurized. It could go to high altitude. It could carry a heavy bomb load, and it could go very long distances. It had to be used in the Pacific. It was just so essential. And Tibbetts was put in charge of the B-29 program and the training program and told to get those men in those airplanes. And he was struggling. It was a real challenge because the men were just refusing to fly it. And so he played on their egos and he laughed when he would tell this story. He just thought it was the funniest thing. He found Dora and Dee Dee, who was down at an airfield, and watched Dora stick a tough crosswind landing in an A-10. And he called over to the barracks where the WASP were, and Dee Dee Mormon answered the phone, and he said, "Who was that girl who flew that in?" And she said, "Well, that was Dora." He said, "Okay, grab her and you and come out to the flight line. We're going to fly." And he took these two women who were, when I give these talks in person, I always point to myself and say they're my height because they were both about 5'5", you know, medium build, not Amazons, not giant women. He took these two women and spent something like 3 or 4 days teaching them to fly the B-29. Like from flying twin engine aircraft experience to all of a sudden you're flying the biggest bomber of the day, 4 engines, pressurized, all of this. Teaching them how to fly it, and then took them on tours of the bases in the United States that had B-29s. And they would fly in and do a demonstration flight for all the pilots and crewmen would come to the runway and watch this demonstration flight of these pilots. And then, you know, grease it on, right? They had to grease in the landings or they got a lot of grief from Tibbetts for it. And then they would all climb out of the planes and the men would all run up and say, "Okay, well, who's the pilots? We want to meet the pilots." And Tibbetts would kind of get his little smile and point to the two, and he would say, to these two little girls who just gotten out of the plane, and say, there's your pilots. And the men would all, oh my God, what are you talking about? And Dee Dee and Dora, who were both very fun, smart, personalities, would say, yes, we're your pilots. And, some of the men tried to quit. Some of the men couldn't believe it. And then Tibbetts would take the men up, and the cockpit area of a B-29 is huge. You could have a party inside of there. It's so big. And they would have, he would have Dee Dee and Dora sit in the cockpit and have, several of the men standing behind them, watching their procedures while they were taking off, while they were coasting, while they were coming in for a landing, and teach the men the procedures by having these women do it. And he did it on purpose to play on their egos. He said, these guys were so sexist that we used it against them and proved that this plane was so easy to fly, even a girl could do it. And he thought it was hilarious. He loved Dee Dee and Dora. Dora continued to fly with him on different bases later on. The project only lasted a couple of weeks because somebody in Washington found out about it and said, you get those girls out of my airplane. You're going to shame my football players, pilots, and we can't hurt their little egos like this. But it worked, the men, the plane now had the reputation of being so easy to fly, even a girl could do it. And none of the men were going to be able to quit, because it was too hard to fly or too dangerous when Dee Dee and Dora had done it. So Tibbetts loved telling that story. I met him in the mid-90s, I guess, and he would tell it every time, and he would laugh. He thought it was the funniest thing ever, this trick they had played on all these men pilots. So, but Dee Dee and Dora were always very gracious about it. And actually, when Dee Dee did her, or when Dora did her check ride with the CAA, she had an engine fire. So the danger of the plane was real. But it was essential. So yeah, Tibbetts, he thought that was the funniest thing he'd ever done.
Yeah, it's just outstanding. Well, this has just been a fascinating conversation, Kate. Really appreciate you sharing all this with us.
Absolutely. I'm so happy to be here. And we've talked about a lot, and there's so much left to talk about. I appreciate you helping me share the story of these amazing women.
Yeah, it's an honor. Yeah, thanks so much. John Long, tell us about today's We Salute You veteran.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the service of Donald R. McCloud, one of America's first to fall at Pearl Harbor. And we gratefully acknowledge the work of the dedicated researchers who recently helped bring him home. Donald Robert McCloud was born in Wayne, West Virginia on November 18, 1920, and grew up about 60 miles away in Logan County. In April of 1938, McCloud enlisted in the U.S. Navy, a popular option for some young men in the Depression, because it offered 3 square meals a day and exciting travel opportunities. Soon, McCloud was assigned to the battleship USS Oklahoma as a fire controlman second class. This meant aboard ship he was to maintain and operate the control systems for the battleship's guns, as well as manning a fire control station in action. Oklahoma spent the last few months of 1941 in dry dock for repairs and then stationed at Pearl Harbor. The old battle wagon was slated to be retired in May of 1942, and very likely many of her sailors looked forward to easy duty in Hawaii until then. But we know it was not to be. December 7th dawned with the Oklahoma moored on Battleship Row alongside the USS Maryland. It's the exact position occupied today by the floating museum USS Missouri. The surprise Japanese attack on that fair Sunday morning hit the Oklahoma hard with aerial torpedoes. The ship absorbed as many as 8 torpedo hits before capsizing to port in less than 12 minutes. Although many men escaped the wreck or were rescued by the heroic efforts of nearby sailors, 429 officers and men aboard the Oklahoma were killed, many of them trapped below decks. One of these was Donald McCloud. Recovery efforts from 1941 to 1944 removed the remains of the deceased sailors, but few could be identified. Some 388 sailors and Marines were buried in the National Cemetery of the Pacific, the Oklahoma, as unknowns from the Oklahoma. The technology of the day allowed little else. Fast forward to 2015. The intrepid researchers at the Defense POW Accounting Agency, the DPAA, began Project Oklahoma to identify as many of the unidentified remains from the ship as possible. Using dental records and mitochondrial DNA from his family, Don McCloud's remains were positively identified in 2016. Last May, the sailor, long dead but never forgotten, was laid to rest in his family cemetery in Mingo County, West Virginia, given a much-deserved hero's welcome back to his home state. So far, 356 of the 388 men unidentified from the Oklahoma have been positively identified by DPAA. Today, the anchor of the USS Oklahoma is on display as a memorial in Oklahoma City. The inscription on the pedestal reads, "Eternal vigilance is the price of liberty." Eternal vigilance certainly describes the service of McCloud and his brothers in arms at Pearl Harbor, and it describes the dedicated work of the DPAA in bringing heroes home and giving the names to the nameless. Donald R. McCloud, we salute you. Thank you for your service, even unto death, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
And what strikes me about that, I mean, it's so long ago, but just what that means to a family, to have the remains accounted for and buried where they want them to be buried. That's so important.
I think the work that the DPAA is doing is incredible. And especially these last decade, you hear so many of these remains that have now been returned to families, and it brings that closure. I think they've needed all these years. So
might make a good podcast subject sometime.
It could.
Great idea. Yeah. I mean, grief needs closure.
That's right.
And that's closure. Yeah. Well, this has been just another fascinating episode. Kate Landdeck, again, thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
You can email our team at podcasts@dday.org. We love hearing from you. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to this podcast, share with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation. Email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I want to give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information.
It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.